Hey there, guys. Norman Santo here. Just want to let you guys know that this episode is a bit derpy because the sound quality is not that good. I tried my best to make everything perfect, but you know how it is. When thing wants to go wrong, it goes wrong. But just a few things to say before I let the episode play. The Friendship Express was awesome and amazing. I would like to give out a personal thank you to Daniel, Anthony, Charlie, and also Meals, and also all the volunteers that were there at the con. You guys were amazing. You guys were the best. And I hope you guys do this again next year. You guys are amazing. So anyway, I'll say my goodbyes here and let you guys listen to the whole show. I'll see you guys later. Bye-bye.
This year, a podcast celebrated its third anniversary. For anything to go into 3 years, it's amazing. Anything. Whether it's a project, you know, a magazine, a blog, 3 years is amazing. And not a single week has this podcast missed an episode. Every Saturday without fail is recording. Every Tuesday, the episode will come out. You can find this on iTunes, you can find this on TuneIn Radio, you can find this on Stitcher Radio. I'm talking about the MBS Show. A podcast that started by my good friend over there, Norman Santo. Started. And I think we'll hit on up and we'll talk about it. We'll let you know if we'll take questions from any of you about it, alright? Let's get going. And here is usually waiting.
Hello everyone, I am Norman Sanzo, host for the MBS Show. The MBS Show.
Thank you. And finally, you get to see the face behind the voice.
So, the MBS Show is a podcast by Bro News. And, well, we try to move along to anyone else who's interested in listening to me ramble on about homes.
It is by far the longest running Malaysian brony project out there. And, I'll give you a little bit of a brief history on how we get some stuff started. Basically, the MBS Show started its journey in February of 2012. And this happened when Norman and I did a little podcast inspired of other brony podcasts such as Bronyville, Electric Brony, the Brony Time wasn't on there yet. There were a few others as well going on. And I thought, why don't we try this in Malaysia? So Norman started it. He put up made a SoundCloud account, threw the audio there, and said, let's see how far this goes. And a few months later, I joined in, and I said, hey, we're doing a good job. Let's take you to iTunes. Let's take this all the way. So I sent the application over to Apple, and about a couple of weeks later, we were accepted to the store, and the MBS Show was listed on iTunes New and Noteworthy. For about 2 weeks, we were on iTunes New and Noteworthy. And now, 3 years later, 150 episodes later, we're here. So Norman, come on.
Yeah. We're on episode number 158. So sorry there, ladies and gentlemen, because one of the few facts of the MBS Show is we derp a lot.
We fix a lot of things in post.
Yes. And doing live shows is not one of our fortes.
So, the Let's Be Cry live.
Yeah, true. So anyway, moving on. Like, what is the MBS Show podcast? Like, I know a few of you here are wondering, like, what are we? Well, for a fact, it's an online radio show made for bronies by bronies. And yeah, it's an interesting concept to begin with. Is someone talking about ponies online, like you never heard that before. So anyway, currently it's hosted by me, Daniel Anthony, James Cork, and Brolicious. These are my trusted friends who I get on every week and talk about ponies. We talk about news, fandom, dramas, or whatever comes into mind. And you can catch this on iTunes, Stitch Radio, and YouTube. The reason why it's on YouTube is because I'm cheap. I don't have the budget. So, a few of you were wondering when did it start? Well, first episode aired on February 25th, 2012. This was an interesting time where I thought, hey, I should do this twice a month at least. That would be easy on me, right? Nope. I thought, nah, let's do this every week. It'll be fun. What could go wrong? What could go wrong?
Well, that also is a thing. If you've been working on a university project or something like that, and you have to edit, probably just a 10-second voiceover or a 10-second narration. Imagine editing a 90-minute long MP3 file full of jerks and little quirks and something that didn't come out right. You gotta just go again and again and again at 19 minutes. Can you imagine doing that 19 times over? You probably see half an hour doing one. I mean, I remember my days in high school, I took about half an hour to edit a stupid 30-second clip of audio.
Well, then, that was back then. Now the longest we have is about 2 hours.
Yeah, it's certainly grown. We had 2-hour episodes. If I'm not mistaken, that was the final drama on Free Network. We had a 2-hour long interview with him.
Oh yeah, I mean, it was fun. But back then, I didn't have a stable setup. So everything that could go wrong went wrong. So, yeah. So episode 1 to 5 started on SoundCloud, and the reason why SoundCloud is because I thought SoundCloud was cool and hype, but apparently it needed money to become cool and hype. So it went to YouTube, where it was not so cool and hype. People like Markiplier would say not. What have we achieved within these 3 years? Well, we interviewed people from the fandom and also from the show. Most notable is The Living Tombstone, which then we'll talk to tomorrow, right?
Yep.
Alright. And Black Griffin. And also Niels. Niels. You there?
Yeah, he's there. Yeah. We talked to Niels before on the show. This is back when he was in Australia. We had a chat with him.
Boo, I cannot see you, man. And also we also interviewed Dusty Cat, the manliest brony in the world. He's the guy with the big mustache. And Saint Pinky. This is an interesting character.
That was a long time ago as well.
Yep. He's the guy that started the con in Malaysia.
Oh wow, who's that?
Yeah, I know. And also MLP Civil Quill, the brony reviewer on the YouTube. He's the hippogriff that's pretty cool. He's a nice guy. But he seems to have a problem with Flash Entry.
And a fun fact, the interview done with Black Griffin was one of the first MBS show interviews done in person.
Ah, yes, that one. That one was full of derps.
But this was done face to face. Norman went face to face with Gabriel Brown to do the interview.
Oh, true that. And also we interviewed people from the show, from Michelle Krieber, the voice of Apple Bloom, and the singing voice of Sweetie Belle, Amy Kitty Rogers, the person who wrote the episode. She's an awesome gal. And Heather Breckel, colorist for the IDW My Little Pony comics. And we've been active for 3 years with over 150 episodes and counting. If this goes out, this will be episode number 158. So, yay!
Yeah, 3 years, long time. I remember 3 years ago he wanted to go for a brony convention. The nearest one was in Manila.
Well, then I'm insane and went to Buck.
I'm more insane, I organized one. Yeah, it's like you go to the convention, I brought the convention here.
Yeah, I don't know, I mean, Buck was one thing, but I'm right bankrupt now. So, what shows do we have? Like, obviously we have a talk show where we interview people, so let me just run down here. For now we have 2 shows, the main episode and the review show. The main episode features the host, me, and my co-host, and guest of the week. The review show features me, James Cork, and Silver Quill, and sometimes guest hosts. And for the main show, it's basically a show where we interview, say, Dan here, and we talk to him about how he started the con and whatnot, and then we roll into news time where we talk about the news. Sometimes we talk about why this happens or how things are, and sometimes we think about why are people so childish in terms of they are complaining about Twilight being a princess and whatnot.
That sounds like Saturday Night Live, you know?
Yeah.
Bring down the drama and bump up the football.
Yep, true. And for the review show that started about last year, this one is a bit special where we review episodes, we talk about them, we break them down and see what we like and dislike about the episodes. But since season 4 has finished, we got nothing to review. So we move on to comics, the IDW Mandalorian comics. And I've invited Silver Quill on as a full-time guest for the review show. And we have been bringing in a storm of reviewing where we talk about comics and whatnot. And some people think that comic books, like especially for ponies, is not good, not fun, it's just silly. But honestly, these comics from IDW are really awesome, and you guys should go and read it if you can. So, what do we have planned for the future? Well, most obvious one is gathering more guests on the show.
That's like a weekly commitment. It's like sometimes Mama would ring me up on a Friday night and like, "Damn, you know, I'm gonna ring you tomorrow. What are you gonna do? What are you gonna do?" And it's quite interesting how sometimes we actually pull guests out on really, really short notice. In fact, we had a guest on one of the episodes. We had Feldo, who's the founder of NLP Forums, which is an online learning community based in Canada. And basically, what I just said to him was, "Dude, are you free? Do you have about 1 hour of your time? Can you have 1 hour of your time?" He's like, "We've got family stuff going on, but I think time is free today." Bang! We just had a guest on call for the episode 5 minutes before it began recording. We're nuts like that.
Yeah, sometimes episodes like that can be nuts because who is this guy? Dan, do you know? He's your friend, right?
He's your friend.
Yep. So it's,
but that's why friendship is magic, because suddenly both are friends.
True. So, second thing on agenda is going to conventions. So, as for now, the only convention that I can go to is locally.
Oh, really?
Yeah, really. I mean, I am broke. I have no money after buck.
Okay.
Did you know all the swag I brought home? Like, my God, my wallet's... No. You know I'm living under a bridge now?
Oh, really? What?
Yeah.
The Golden Bridge?
Yeah, I wish. But the next thing is doing a show live and streaming. I've been hanging around a lot of Picarto artists, and they stream a lot. And the interaction that they have between fans and artists is really awesome. And I want that for myself. Call me greedy, but that is really fun to experience. And lastly, starting a gaming channel. It's nothing so serious. It's just me derping around, playing games, and having fun.
And you say you're derping around, I get scared. Because when you derp around, I must derp around even more.
Hey, Dan, you and me, Left 4 Dead 2.
Yeah, exactly. You were looking at Left 4 Dead, I was looking at the blue screen of
Dan. But, so, Dan here believes in friendship is magic. And I believe that we have friends that we want to promote. So, friends of ours that you should take a look at is, look at and follow is, I'm Brony and Proud at the Twitter handle.
IBAIP Show.
Yeah.
Okay.
He's a wonderful guy. He started off slow and worked his way up now. And currently, he will be played on Cantaloupe Hill, the new channel that replaced
Everfree Network.
Yeah.
In case you all don't know, Everfree Network has officially ceased operations as of January 1st, 2015. And they have passed over Everfree Radio, which is one of the longest running Brony radio channels in the world. I mean, Celestia Radio beat them, of course. But one of the longest running Brony radio channels in the world is now at the Cantaloupe Hill.
Yep, true that. And after that is Team OK, because Team OK is but it's actually a charity group where it's run by bronies for bronies or for whoever. We gather every week, we help people who are in need. Join, we band together and help. And these guys are okay and you should follow too. And the last few is Ponyville Live. They're the first online radio station that helped us get online and get us more viewers. Without them, we won't be here with the numbers that we have.
Yeah, definitely. Ponyville Live is a fantastic platform. It's like it's like Astro for Brony content, almost, in a sense. You know, you get tuned in, and maybe more like Netflix. you get to choose what you want to watch and you see what's playing on each channel. It's really, really something awesome.
Yeah, true. And last but not least, Equestria Daily.
Yes. In particular, this one goes out to you, Calpain, because Calpain was our official point of contact for the Friendship Express, and he helped us get our announcements up on Equestria Daily, and I'm pretty sure some of you all would have seen these announcements, and if you saw an announcement on EQD for this event, and if that's the reason why you're here, that's fantastic to hear, and Calpain, we owe that to you.
Calpain, I'm calling you out. Why I didn't see my promotion for this? And we move on to the last part, Q&A. Feel free to talk to us your questions and we'll try to answer them.
Yeah, basically, the MBS show, after 3 years of running, we've seen some stuff. We've seen a lot of stuff. We've seen how some people can be difficult on air. We've seen how people are nice on air. We've seen how people can't shut up on air. We've seen people who don't know how to talk on air. So we've seen a fair share of the fandom. And it took us a while, but after about the second year, we started to run out of local people to interview. So we started to expand a bit more, start to look overseas, start to find bronies who are in the woodwork, or sometimes those that are known, and get them onto our show. And we find interesting little bits of information, like, did you all know that Assertive Fluttershy was born in Malaysia? The brony musician Assertive Fluttershy was born in Malaysia. He's staying in Canada.
I didn't know that.
Did you all know that the Ponyhoof Facebook plugin was coded and built by a Malaysian?
That was episode 2.
Yeah. And there's a lot more stuff that has been built by Malaysian bronies, and we're putting it up on the net, and we're putting it out there, you know. It's in a way we're carrying the whole Malaysia Boleh spirit, but we also want to bring out a lot of bronies who are in the fandom who need the attention, who should garner more attention. So, if you have any questions for us, or perhaps even a suggestion, a request, or if you want to know how we work, what we do, or how a regular show goes, just feel free to ask us. Anybody questions? Don't be shy. I mean, we are used to dishing out questions day in, day out, so now's your turn.
Yeah, it's true. We like to talk, and sometimes if we don't have a topic to talk to or talk about, it's kind of hard for us. And we can ramble one, but you really want to see the guy ramble for what? Half an hour? 1 hour long?
Isn't that what we do every week?
So, yeah, why don't you go down and hunt for people? I mean, look for people.
Alright. So, first of all, I'd like to know how many of you here listen to the MBS show on iTunes or anywhere? How many of you actually know about the show?
How many of you are aware that the MBS show exists? Alright, okay, we've got one more. We've got a few down there. Yes, there are people who know that the show exists. We understand that in Malaysia, podcast culture never really caught on. A lot of people don't know what this particular button on the iPod does. I think they press it and it's good, okay? So, the thing is, when we opened up and started the adult podcast culture here, it was difficult. Because prior to joining the MBS show, I had my own podcast. I did a podcast in my university called the Lion Podcast. And it was an experimental ground for me to learn about the industry, how podcasting works, how we can take content and streamline it in a different way. And it's also an experiment to see, there's a difference between a blog and a podcast, difference between a YouTube channel and a podcast. The difference is that a podcast is mainly audio. And the purpose of doing things like this is that you can deliver content to people and they can take it, they can listen to it while driving or going for a jog or something like that. And that's how we adopted a podcast model here. So, we're actually going to enlighten you a bit because I don't see many questions coming out. So, here's something that we'd like to enlighten you all on. Getting to the MBS show is very easy. First of all, you can listen to all the podcasts that are embedded in the website, thembshow.com, correct?
Yes, yes.
Another way to do it is you can log on to iTunes and you can own any Apple device that has Wi-Fi, that's like your iPod Touch, iPhone, and iPad. It goes all the way to the Macs, and even on iTunes or Windows. Just as for the MBS show, look in the podcast section. You should see the album art that looks like what you see the background up there. It's the latest 2015 update of the album art. It reminds me of Gorilla's Demon Days. And you can listen to episodes completely free. Podcasts are completely free. We don't charge a cent for this. And Norman has an interesting policy with the podcast that, you know, he told me this. We do this for free. We do this for free. So we don't collect money, we don't collect donations and stuff like this because we want to do something for the community. And that's how we do it. We give back to the community and our listeners become the payment that we really want.
So, true that. I mean, the only reason why I don't take cash from the people is because I don't think it's right. Because we as producers, or people like us, who take other people's work or take other people's idea and think that it's our own, and sometimes take money and whatnot, to me it's not fair, it's not right. So what I do is, I do it out of love, I do it out of dedication, I do it out of insanity.
And also, the NPS show has been trying to get a panel at previous conventions. There have been a few conventions in the region, and this is the first time we've managed to secure a panel at an event. And, you know, forgive us for any jerks that we might have here. I mean, it's a weekly thing, so your forgiveness is already going to set it for me. So, the NPS show has been part of culture within the Malaysian Brony. It started off because the primary Malaysian Brony group is NPS. Then again, people come to us and ask us, what does the MBS and MBS show stand for? Is it the Malaysian Brony Show? That won't make sense. It's the Malaysian Brony Show. So,
then it happened.
How do we answer that question?
Look, the original show meaning was supposed to be the Malaysian Brony Show, or at least some sort of generic title, as in Malaysian Brony something or Brony. I don't know, it was hard to find a name. And originally, I was active in MBS, for those who know what MBS is. So, I just took the monitor in, and, you know, said, this could be fun. I took local people, so I just put it the MBS show, without even thinking about what happened if I go far.
It's interesting, so you always find these kind of people and they'll say that Norma tells me this all the time. He said, 3 years ago, I went up there and said, one day you're gonna have a tour, 300 episodes, 150 episodes on iTunes. He will call me mad. I'm yet to hear him call me mad. Yep, all right. Okay, good, that's the first time. Yeah, thanks. And it's the same thing that happens to a lot of burn projects out there. A lot of burn projects have grown way out of proportion to become huge. Let's go with a simple example. BronyCon in America, in Baltimore, Maryland. BronyCon had a simple grassroots in New York City. In a hotel room, less than 5% the size of this place. It was so small, it was so cramped. They didn't have a stage. They had a table and they had a panel on that table. They had one day, a Saturday, in a little place called, in a little hotel in New York City. There were people standing at the back. The turnout was fantastic. And they knew that they had to grow. Fast forward to 2014. BronyCon had moved all the way from New York City to Greater New York, and then far down south to Baltimore, Maryland, to the Baltimore Convention Center. They are now regarded as a tourism highlight of Baltimore. In Visit Baltimore year, Visit Malaysia year, Visit Singapore year and all this, BronyCon is highlighted as one of the Visit Baltimore events. And the convention last year reached 5 figures worth of attendees. 10,000 Bronies from all over the world were attending BronyCon. That's how big it has become. Now, with this kind of event, you know, with the Friendship Express, the reason, you know, we can't really reach that level is because we're quite far. It takes a certain degree of pop culture to know about this. But even the MBS show came about because within this little island in the middle of nowhere, this little accidental line that God drew underneath Asia and suddenly became Malaysia, is, how do you say, we are a small community. But that doesn't mean we're a quiet one. That doesn't mean that nothing happens here. Things happen here. Maybe not big, but these things have potential. These things can grow. These things can become so big. Like, just look at things like Tony Hawk. Tony Hawk has over 1 million installs on the internet. 1 million Chrome browsers running Tony Hawk. 1 million Firefox browsers running Tony Hawk. He didn't make it for Internet Explorer, that upset me because I'm an IT fan. Anyway, I eat that. So, he didn't know and didn't expect it to become that big. But we give people like this, like this car, a stage to stand on. We give people like Neil Meals is another great example. Meals had a YouTube channel for a few years. A couple of years back, a game called Karaoke is Magic came out, built on the UltraStar platform. It is an open source variant of SingStar for the Nintendo Wii. And he suddenly messaged me and said, I didn't know someone took his song from his YouTube channel, input it into the game, and made it a distributable copy. So a game, a karaoke game, had a Malaysian growing song on it.
Oh, then, fun fact, sometimes they do not.
Usually you don't ask anyway. But it's a shocker. He wasn't upset at it. He was like, wow, people actually, you know, look out for these things. And there are things that do.
I talked to Rick. Rick, I still remember. He's the guy who gave Karaoke Magic. I met him personally and talked to him about the whole education, how he did it, and what goes to doing it. And sometimes it's just a matter of, let's do this, and if they ask us to remove it, we'll do it again.
Yep, and then maybe there's a piece of fighting with magic. Even that was done, and you know, somehow some projects know that they've got a graveyard coming up, you know, they know they're going to die one day, and so going to come back and gone. But they still do it anyway. It's a little labor of love for the fandom. And likewise, in this region, people have told us, many times, people like me, but normally told us, like, why do you want to do a Brony convention here? Why? Why do I do one in Malaysia? You know, no future here, like, it's not going to happen here, it's not going to pick up, blah, 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 blah. It's not related to that for us. So, last year, in fact, 2 years ago, I got an email from somebody asking me if I wanted to be part of the committee for a Singapore Brony convention. I said, why are you Singapore? And that's the moment I thought, okay, I'll give this a shot. Why not? You know, Singapore's close enough. 70 ringgit by Air Asia. So I hopped down there and gave them a hand with what became Tesla University Reloaded 2014. And that was a surprise for all of us. The turnout level of 115 attendees. Fantastic for a little red dot called Singapore. Tiny little dot down there. 115 attendees at its first growing convention. Fantastic feat. And in fact, we decided to even bump it up. December last year, we had an open Brony art festival called the Car Girl Slash. Unfortunately, we got stepped on by the rain, so it didn't turn out so well. And then that's when I decided to come home. I mean, I never left to Singapore, but I came home after that and I said, you know, we got together and we said, why don't we try this year? Just try it. We've got a lot to lose. It's not like we have nothing to do, but we said, let's try. Let's give it a shot. Let's see if the Malaysian Brony will come. And here you all are. And I would have to say that projects like the MBS show carry through with this idea. They help people like us, the Committee of the Friends Express. They help people like Temple University. They help people in the region reach the global audience. The MBS show has a bell help. So, how many subscribers do
you have? Oh, this is 370.
There we go, 370 subscribers from all over the world, listening to perhaps every week, or every other week. She's not live, she's listening to whenever they want. So, 370 subscribers, 350 people are hearing us.
Fun fact, on YouTube, the most recent country is the US, and second to that is Malaysia.
So there we have it, the United States of America. Can finally see what Malaysia can do. People, we have been able to get a voice out from this country. And we owe a lot to Norman. We put up a lot of work for this. He put through, and the thing is, you know, I honestly thought maybe the MBS show would survive the 100th episode, and because after the 100th, it's really hard to keep on. It's really, really hard to push up after the 100th. The 100th episode of any podcast is a fantastic achievement. But after the 100th comes the real challenge. Because you know the next milestone is 500 or 200 or whatever. It's still a long way off. But we're halfway to 200. We're more than halfway. We're 158 episodes through. And it's because the loyalty that has been shown in this is that he just doesn't give up. It's not... It's very easy to give up in a growing community that is saturated with, you know, not just saturated, not even saturated, it's very sparse, it's very scattered out. And a lot of people on MBS were complaining about this event. They're complaining about the Central Express, saying why is it not in Kelantan, why is it not in Penang, why is it not in Sarawak, why is it not in Johor, why is it not in, you know, not even better, why is it not in Tekong, why is it not in Putrang, why is it not in KL, why is it not in Gombak? you complain about Gombak. But we do what we can at our capacity. I'm a KL boy. In fact, I live in FS2, I live nearby. You know, you throw a stone outside the public gate, window. That's how near I am to this place. I grew up in this town and I've known this place for a long time. And when the community got together, we said, let's look at the options we have. Much like how the NBS show looked at it in East Town Club, East Newfield, and East Kingdom. Look at this. Now, we looked at all this and we found the best place to be here. Because the price of the space as well. And how do you say, when it came to the NBS show, it's actually the mindset that I would say I learned from these guys. I learned from Norman. What I learned from Norman is that how we actually chose what our weapons of choice were. The inner workings of the NBS show is really simple. It uses a hosted MP3 file, and we link it to iTunes for them to aggregate and turn it into the podcast. We have a lot of choices. We could use SoundCloud, we could use YouTube, we could use Tindex, or those other silly a Libsyn, or there are a few more professional podcasting platforms that charge a bomb or something like that. But what we decided to do was, let's build our own. And that's the beauty of a lot of things that are Malaysian made in the Brony family as well. They're built from the ground up. Prior to Ponyhook, there was a phone plugin called Ponyfire, which got me into trouble at university. Because it changes everybody to every pony, anybody to any pony. So I happily copy paste one article that day. Oh my god. Actually, Daniel, you just downloaded an article about ponies. I was looking for an article about humans. It's an article about humans from Time Magazine. Anyway, I can't plug in the song. But it just developed from things like that. And in Malaysia, we pride ourselves on taking things that are not ours, but not turning into ours. So that's what happened with the MBS show. We took ideas from perhaps a lot of it, I think, was inspired by Donegal, correct?
Some of it. Originally, I was inspired by the movie podcast back then, but it didn't have been any life. So I was still into podcasting, and Donegal was there, so. But hey, this sounds fun, listen. And thought, hey, I could do this, I don't have friends. Until February of 2012, where I went. Here's the thing. February of 2012, joined the fandom, got no idea who's who. All I know is this guy named Bobo online. And then like, I said, I'm thinking of going to this event called Art Jam on February. So it sounds fun. So I said, hey, I'm interested in going, but I don't have a place to stay. And Aaron out here invited me in to stay with him. And out of nowhere, I said, hey, let's go. Pick me up, stay this place. And from that point on, like, okay, this is fun. But something clicked. I got no idea who he is. I don't know how he looks. I'm staying in a stranger's house.
It's not the same here, I'm staying with you. In case you all don't know, Norman here is actually from Johor Bahru. Not a KL boy. He came all the way up a bit. And that is something that is very commendable with a lot of people here. Winston is from... Gampa, yes, Gampa. Sorry, my geography is failed. I think Langkawi is Sarawak. We've got Ronson over there, and he came from Penang. All the way to Alsa, I can't remember another one. And this dude came from Gombak as well.
And
then
we have people from Singapore.
Yes, yeah, people from Singapore as well. We have Murray from Singapore came all the way.
Still, it's one of those situations where we really want it, we really want it, we'll go for it, even if it sounds dangerous.
I mean, if you have read the complete story of, not the complete story, like the story that we wrote on the topic? No. The story on the Venture Express website about how we came up with the event, and it says there three words: hardened by failure. And it is truly hardened by failure. This convention is the result of the three failed conventions that were attempts to hold this. Three failed tries at doing this. But the thing that people like me and my friends here pulled through is that you say, what is it worth? Is it worth one more shot? And why not? Is it one more shot? One more shot, okay? One more shot. And it's that spirit that helps us to not give up. And today, we're really, really happy to see so many of you here. That really happens. Yep.
And as far as I can see, we had a maximum of 81 attendees.
Oh, yeah. So, I mean, more than that, I think, way more than that, because some people are here who didn't use a passport, and some people are here who are, we're not playing the blue passport, the friendship passport, and there's some walking attendees as well, so I believe we probably easily get 100 people here today.
Wow.
So yeah. Give yourself a round of applause for that, guys. Give yourself a round of applause. Thank you so much for coming out.
Here's one of the key secrets of the NBS show. I shut up and listen, while others do the work for me.
That's something I'm not very good at. I don't want to talk.
Like, you do the work for me, and I'm just sitting down.
Yeah, I have questions to ask everyone.
Yeah. So, talking about questions, do you guys have any questions for us? Anything? You don't know anything more?
Anything at all, because, you know, 3 years of podcasting, what you've seen, what you've known. I know we got tapped in the face before. We have some, I believe.
I mean, do you want us to walk around and go in front of you and put the mic at you? I don't know, maybe you want?
No, but I want to hear the content, but they got questions, so don't be shy. We've talked to a wide variety of people. We've talked to so many people. We've talked to people who cannot shut up, and we've talked to people who cannot talk.
You know, one of the problems of talking to a lot of people is they do a lot of
And the thing is, you can't run away. Everyone knows at the NBA show you can blind test 10,000 podcasts in front of people. No, it comes to, hey, what's going on to the NBA show?
Everybody will know the Malaysian version show.
I mean, there have been attempts at other Brody podcasts, like Singapore Brody Society, they have to start one as well, but the difference is they never kept it up. You know, they restructure, they didn't keep it up. I'm not making slam them in any way, but the difference is that if you do something, you keep it up, you go for it. Even if you are forced to pull down something, like my own podcast, the Life podcast, after serving 108 episodes, I have closed up because I couldn't keep it up anymore. You know, the bill, I used a professional service to host it because of the university project. I was hosting it on Amazon Web Services, which cost a lot of money. So I had to shut down the server after about 2 years, 2.5 years of podcasting. But if you can't, I mean, you leave behind a legacy as well, because nothing lasts forever. But the longer you go, you know, it just shows how you persevere.
Didn't you also have technical jerks in the server?
Yeah, I had a lot of technical jerks in the server. The thing is that I began on a very basic, cheap server, you know, a very basic level. Like, okay, we'll give you this, make sure you don't overstep your boundaries. And eventually, it grew. It started to grow. Project always grows. Mm-hmm. And one day, this project just overgrew its boundaries by that little bit. It hit the limit, and I had to move up. So I went up about 3-4 times before I hit. I had to go for what's called infrastructure as a service, which was basically a very high level of cloud computing where you had to design your own server and system. And that was when I had to, on my own accord, pull up research and understand how to do this within 2 weeks. Because if I did not pull it up within 2 weeks, every day that the server is down, I lose listeners, I lose content, I lose exposure. I had to get it back up. If it's gone for more than 2 weeks, people think, okay, it's okay, time to move on.
Yeah, that's the problem there with podcasts, because if you don't do weekly updates, people will have issues, or people will think that this show is not active anymore.
And not just that, sometimes your podcast, another thing that you get to note is, what you do right now, what you're doing right now, you're coming out to public to show this thing to the people. Because online marketing is hard as hell. Online marketing is difficult. You go to Facebook, it's full of ads. You go to Google, it's full of ads. You go to Gmail, it's full of ads. You enter the Gmail, you go see your email, got ads some more. So the thing is, they're everywhere. How do you get an edge? How do you get an advantage? The advantage for me, as a broadcaster, and we are all the students, communication students, sorry. I can't remember what I'm saying. So, is that when you have the personal level of communication, like right now, we're a people, we're not even on stage anymore, we're down here with you. That's the level of that actually pushes things that one step further. And that's how we're going to be on the show as well. You're no longer talking to a website. You're no longer talking to join the herd or little of mine. You're no longer talking to the French Express or org. You're talking to the people behind you. You're talking to someone who's human, who can respond. And most importantly, it's not perfect.
Oh yeah, like I said before, we are known for dirt. And fun fact, the NBA show's first mascot was dirty.
Yeah, that's true. But then the thing is, what I'm saying is, when you talk to something that's human, when you talk to something that can respond to you, that has flaws, and it's really good to come down and be down to earth with you, that's when you go places. That's what it means.
What I've been doing most of the time is go to new people and you meet you guys. I mean, I've never said who I am, I never boast about what I do. I'm just the guy who's handing the booth, selling you t-shirts for $50, go buy that shirt, it's really cool, and go buy the flowers, it's 120, and just have a good time. And also don't forget to buy drinks 150. And I just really for the fun of it. I have a day job, I have a responsibility, but in all honesty, this shirt is fun. Being up on here, I would have thought that I would be nervous, like I would be shaking, I would be like,
For the first time, maybe, but you know, you built that confidence through 3 years of podcasting. Yeah. That actually comes out. I mean, I would recall your first episode was good, and it's supposed to shake you. Even if you're not looking at people on the other end, you're trying to talk to them, it was still shaky. You kind of hold that.
Remember the first episode? First guest. Wow, that was full of dirt. Also, the second episode, remember?
Oh, yes, I remember.
That was on February.
Yeah.
No, was it
cool? What? I was just not outside.
I was sleeping with you.
I was sleeping with you.
One of them replied, I look, and it was tested for himself. I showed this to them. Didn't say anything, pushed the laptop, they didn't see. What did you do?
I'm sorry?
I got a message. I was in shock. You asked why. Pushed the laptop to you. What was your response?
The first thing I saw, the first thing I had an email message, especially because I used Gmail. Suddenly I see a message, and I'm like, suddenly there's this American biker wanna give me an inheritance for $10 million. No way. And I was like, wow. In fact, the first person I thought of was Norman, because, you know, for lack of a better word, it takes balls to ask things like that. It takes balls to go out and ask people, yeah, I would like to interview you. I mean, I work full time in the news industry. I know how hard it is to get an interview. In fact, I just started the news industry a few months back, but I have had friends who have been pushed, shoved, smacked in the face and kicked out of the event hall because they're journalists. And because of that, you know, it made me realize it really takes balls to ask like that. And that's the kind of spirit that brings them to where you are now.
True that. The whole thing is just us. There's no harm in just asking. I even asked a restaurant to join, or even Loin Pao. They didn't reply, but still, I did ask. If they say yes, then what happened? It's just my new thing of, what if they say yes? Then, things would have been,
things would have been crazy. I mean, even for event attendance, we all know Vincent Tom will be on set tomorrow with us. So Lily Johnson will be on set tomorrow with us. Now, okay, we'll be very honest. Vincent Tom actually asked us. It's the other way around. Now that's when we got shocked. We didn't send the first email at all. Vincent Tom actually asked us whether he could be at our convention. And we said, we would love to have you here, but we had to look at the bill. And unfortunately, we couldn't afford that bill. And at the first year convention, we would have quadrupled the budget of this entire event just to bring you here for 2 days. So because of that, we said no. And then came another surprise email. He said, how about Skype? How about Skype? You want Skype for everything? Yes, you do. How about Skype? And he said, you think about it? No, he didn't. He said, let's ask the Malaysian Brony. And then we had our crowdfunding campaign. And we hit goal. And that's what we're doing tomorrow with the 91. So, for the rest of it, like, Tombstone, we asked him, previous conventions at Temple University, Gaijin, and all of those, we talked to some of their voice actresses, the voice actors and their representatives. Some are friendly, some are not, some are divas, some are a bit more, used to real life and stuff. So, there are a wide variety of them. It takes a lot of guts to talk to these people, but you do it. And even if that email comes back with a K, you'll be happy that we actually notice you.
Well, that's true. Me trying to get a guest for at least 158 episodes sometimes doesn't work too. I invite people on. They get a reply. What do you do when you don't have a guest?
He calls me when I'm in the car and I'm like, I'm the goat! And I have a pop on here, I said, and I even joined an interview from the car once using to my iPad.
That was good. Yeah, I mean, he says that I'm educated, but he is even more educated. Take a look at what's going on now. Take a look around you. Take a look at the percentage left of you.
I had to cut that a bit because it's not just me.
Huh?
It's not just me. We have a team. Chia, Neil, Eric, our awesome volunteers today, all of these people made this event a success. You know, I can't bear it. It's not me, it's not just me. I know it was probably my idea, and it was, it went through me quite a bit, and I stood up in the face of the event, but, it's not just me. We put together a lot of collaborative effort for them.
It's true, but in the end of the day, you're the face.
Yeah, but, every event that I have a face. I'm not very pretty face, but because of that, the real pleasure we get from this, we're not earning money from this, just walking for free. We don't even get money from the parking machine. Yeah, I know the parking rate is good, it's 110 cents per hour, so prepare for it. I'm serious, the parking machine is a bit weird here. But, we're not here to earn money, we're not here to get a profit. If we do, if we by any chance do get a profit, we'll definitely do it again. But the thing is, that's not our priority, that's not what we came here to do. We didn't come here to suck your time or something. We know our merch is a bit expensive. But we do a lot of things ourselves. The posters are printed, but even the t-shirts you see this, I was up to 5 a.m. last night printing this. Because we invested in a t-shirt printer to get these things done ourselves. So, I was up late last night,
then you have more days to
do. Oh yes, and I'm glad to hear that people like the design.
Yeah.
So, it took like 5 people to help us put up that backdrop last night because, the determination that people have is fantastic. It's not like we decided, okay, this is not working, forget it.
I mean, even if we do something, we see it to the end. We don't give up halfway, we just...
Exactly. There's always an end to things. Nothing lasts forever. But, determined is something that best for that day is the part that matters.
I think they're rolling around the screen.
Yeah, we have. And this is the trademark of the NBA show. We'll do this all week long.
So, any questions from you guys? Because we need one question right now. We're just over questions.
If not, then nothing. If you do not, I have not watched it, and I am allergic to spoilers. So Norman, go ahead.
For this year, then I'm following you.
Really? Yeah. For once, you're not watching the spoilers.
Yeah. The season 5 has been a year's wait. It has been almost no. It has been over a year. So for me to go and say, hey, I want to spoil it, but yeah, I've been trying, it's going to come out on April 4th, but I don't care, I mean, it's not a date, so I just want to say, hey, this is a spoiler.
The thing is, I really don't like spoilers, because for MLT, the one thing that really got me was the element of surprise that I'm watching the picture and actually liking it.
Yeah,
so, the very thing about spoilers is, I watch with minimal spoilers, close to zero. In fact, I would even prefer if I don't know the episode title.
Okay.
Down to that level of trying to avoid spoilers, because I have seen a bit because people share things on Facebook that I have to see, you know? Because I share a lot of things on Facebook that I force down people's throat. But then, because I happen to see some of these, I don't like it, but sometimes I put up with it. But the thing is that when it comes to this part of this show, I like to go in completely clear, don't know what's going to happen, I don't know what's coming up. And often it's going to download it. There are some times when I just have to double check scenes, and I love the video of having to do that. And that probably that same scene would have been in the trailer, but in the episode, if I double check it, just to confirm, wow, that's actually how good it was. Trailer is always going to be the best of an episode. So when you, even movie trailers, it's a distillation of a movie. So when you take the best of the movie out, and you just watch the movie with all its supper, it doesn't become fun for me anymore.
Very true, true. Except for
that
came out earlier on
Comic Con,
I think.
Comic Con, I think.
Except for that, I seen a bit of it, and let's just say the animation took over. Any more questions?
Don't have any questions, then
just move on with another. If not, then I think that's cool.
Yeah, we will wrap up. Now we'll move on to what?
I just wondering what the NLT ended it season just in season 5. What will you do? Will you continue the podcast or just stop right there? Can I have your autograph, please?
Okay. Sure, sure. So I'm going to ask you your first question first. And what if season 5 was the last season for NLP? So the thing is, all good things come to an end. You don't want to become a dog installation firm. No. So if it ends, it ends on a high, then we all will remember for the best of it. All the good episodes with Al coming in, and all of the episodes and Smile Song, we will remember for the good things. And probably there will be another season or generation, because Hasbro's not going to drop the ball with not producing more shows. But we here right now are part of the fourth generation. We really enjoyed the episode. It might not for what is to come. But if it ends, it ends. There's nothing you can do, there's nothing you can do anymore about it. You just have to accept it and move on.
Then again, I've always loomed on the probability of the 5G, dead end. But looking at what the fandom does, I don't think the art and games and comics and music is going to end with season 5. It's not. We're going to see a lot more art. We're going to see a lot more fanfiction. Especially if there are unresolved things. I mean, the kids show. Sometimes they don't resolve anything. You know, I still don't know. I still insist that the book that came out at the end of season 3 is the last checkbook. You know, because we lost the back to Celestia when we got here at 2000 bits. So there's things, there are unresolved things. Fluttercat's fan is still there. And fanfiction will boom. Fanfiction will probably be the future of NLP. I'm not saying you're going to take the 50 Shades of Grey product fanfic kind of direction now, but and saying you're in the future. Because you look at it, Twilight is over already, like, the movie is over, but look at what's happening in the show right now. But not in that sense.
I mean, also, you see the thing. Does anybody know the show Firefly? It still has a strong following to this day. So, you know, it ends. The Brony Saga will not end. It will still go strong. There will be fan fiction, there will be art, there will be game developers, and there will be a lot of other things that people will want to do for it. And people who are involved with this fandom has gone to greater length or greater height. Does anyone know Children of the Night? The animation? Very hard to do. He is a Canadian animator. I'm friends with him. And he's now working for Disney. Or part of Disney somehow. An animation company. So, it doesn't mean that if you're in the fandom, you leave it, or if you don't want to be in it, you have to stop. I don't want to come stand at this show. I'm going to the Steven Universe fandom now.
Yeah. There's also a sense of saying that you don't like talent enter the show. So if you can draw, or if by any talent, no, I just can't draw in front of the LP. And that's a great talent. And one thing is that for your whole life, you will never forget what made you start drawing. I've been a musician for 15 years. But I've never released a full-on song that I wrote myself until Overtime Aftermath, which came out last month. This is one of, this is one of the songs that I have to explore until the back. That was the first time I released a song that I wrote and sang on my own. And, you know, it came a long way, but what I think took is for me to give you a slap in the face and tell me it's about time you moved on and did something with this talent. So, it was a song that I wrote for a few years. Before this convention came about, I was talking about Friendship Express in my Evernote account. Before this convention even existed, it just became the stars aligned and released it at just the right time for me. So it's something that I've taken even back. It's now gotten my gears turning much more and music. Even though I've been a musician for 15 years, it's been very quiet, but now it's starting to get much more happy.
Yeah, I mean, you always have your own label, like Crystal
and Top Rank, that is big enough for this. Yeah, there's a brand new label called Crystal Empire Records that I'm running as well for Burning Music in the region. If you want to be a part of it, just let me know, because we're taking Burning Music and I think we all have a place to put it. So we're going to be getting on YouTube very soon. In fact, we are filing for content ID and from the song to help raise money. So, yay!
That's awesome.
So, any more questions, guys? Okay. Okay, well, I'm going to do the last one, alright? Alright, cool. What are your thoughts on Hasbro selling out season tickets like this to several of the more prominent and popular fan works? You know, like Batman Adventures and Spike Lee Magic.
You're gonna think that, oh, I'm gonna hate this, oh, this is Hasbro bad, oh, no. Honestly speaking, this is in their life. They have to do it. They have to do it because they own the IP. Just imagine this. You create something of your own creation. It's making you money. Suddenly, then here is doing something that's making you money too, or getting your popularity
to start off part.
Not in the sense that, not in the sense of that.
Yeah, I know.
But
it's why you should buy the total list and not the gold list.
But the fact of the matter is, if you own something, you need to protect it. That's how bad the law is in the States.
Yeah, it's an American law called US trademark law. Like the office that registered the trademark, such as, you notice that if you buy a blind bag or a microphone toy, that's official by Hasbro, you're only seeing the Twilight Sparkle TM, KP5 TM, Apple Jack TM. Now the reason for this is a trademark. That means your company is saying, this is the name of something I'm selling. I'm not going to allow other companies to use it. In the event someone else uses that name to sell something, even if it's a similar product, and you come to knowledge about it, you are obliged to protect it. Otherwise, that person can claim it if you don't claim it. It's not like copyright, it works in a more fluid manner. It's a lot of legal stuff, it's very complicated, and the worst part about it is it differs between different countries. So if you notice, cease and desist have been happening mostly in America, in countries where the copyright and trademark laws align and are quite similar. But there are countries which are very liberal with their intellectual property, and there are grey zones that cannot be touched, such as fighting with magic, city edition. The developers are anonymous. I know who they are, but they are anonymous to the public. So Hasbro doesn't know where to find these people. And that's the thing, you can't destroy what you can't see.
The easiest thing is doing a project like that. If you're creating a very popular game, say fighting with magic, the thing is, don't hype it up at all. Just make it and finish it and release it. If Hasbro wants to chase you down, too bad, it's already not for it. And again, think about it. Like, okay, you ask us to stop, we stop. But it's already done for them. It's already everywhere. So with fighting this magic, they got too big because they got promoted like evil. And people know about it. People knew who they are, who they were, what they were doing, and haters complained. Hasbro doesn't want to do this. They see this as free publicity. They think this is awesome. People are looking at our brand and looking at things like and seeing people like that or maybe somebody else think that, hey, maybe they will buy the toys or maybe they will buy the episode. Because it's free advertising. But if someone sends them a letter, a registered letter, and they receive it, they are required by the law.
They're not required by law. But if they fail to observe it, they stand to lose what they created. And if they do, Hasbro, we all know, will never give up on the problem. They've held the intellectual property for 30 years. Founded in 1982, celebrating its third anniversary in 2012. The 30th anniversary in 2012, they held on to the top spot. No, 33 years, holding on to the same property that brought them so much money. They bought it out, bought it factory, and even G3, G2, all this, it made them a lot of money. Don't just buy the coin, and now they make even more money off it.
Fighting is dead. Dead in the water. There's no way for it to grow. Look at what's come out of it. The developers of the game, Fighting is Magic, have developed a new game called Pose, I think. It's a four-legged fighting game with characters that are Lapakas or even Llamas and whatnot.
Yeah.
And Lauren House is helping them with the design. So, you have that. Out of the burning ashes of one project, you get another.
That's the product I'm talking about. Yep. And so, with that, thank you very much. I know we talked for a long time. Yeah, we talked for a really long time. But thank you very much for listening. We're going to wrap up the MDX Show panel for the evening. Thank you very much, Norman, for coming all the way.
So, my pleasure, Jimmy. I'm satisfied.
Yay! And you started the show, so I really had the pleasure of giving you the stage today because it deserves the attention and the place that, you need a place to shine. And that's what